Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for joining me. It's good to have everybody tune in for our May 2021 Clubhouse meeting. And we have a lot of great things planned for you. And I'm just so delighted that you chose to spend a little time with me. We have been talking about grids all year long. So we did feathers all year long for 2020, and for 2021, we're talking about grids. And one of the things that is my goal today is to kind of show you how versatile grids are, because you can kind of get locked into a box thinking about grids, no pun intended, but if you look at grids in kind of a different way, there's so many different uses for grids, and it's a really wonderful way to kind of launch yourself into free motion quilting because you have freedom with boundaries. So we're gonna explore a lot about that today. Specifically using grids in borders. But I do want to make sure if you have any questions, I mean, you've got my ear, so put them over there in the chat comment. We are monitoring, so we live stream this on both our Facebook group, the Quilted Joy Clubhouse Facebook group, as well as on YouTube. As well as on our website. So there's lots of places that you can watch our Clubhouse meeting. And I just encourage you to pop over there in the comments. It's always fun if you pop over and say, you know, what city you're in, because we hit some far-flung cities, Canada, US, Australia, Netherlands, all over the place. So I'd love it if you pop over and tell me what town you're watching from, where you are. And any questions that you may have, put them over there. We've got folks, Jessie is monitoring our chat, and she'll let me know if you have a question, and I'll do my best to answer it. So think about what you want to ask me, because you got me for a little while, so why not take advantage of it, right? And I wanted to be sure that you are signed up for our Quilted Joy newsletter. Because in that newsletter, we will send you a reminder that the club has Clubhouse Day, but we'll also send you some supplemental materials and worksheets that go along with the monthly lesson. So be sure you're on our newsletter. We also post fun things like, oh, I just posted a link that went out in the newsletter this morning for this Instagram account that finds old quilts that are kind of worn out and have holes and can't be resurrected, and they make clothing out of them, even clothing for cats. So I thought it was really kind of fun, and I put a link in there for that. So we just do little fun things in our newsletter, and we'd love to have you be a part of it. So definitely you want to make sure that you sign up. And then our other big news, so last month we launched our Glide Thread mini packs, and these are limited edition mini packs of threads that we've hand curated with the best of colors that'll go together for you with different themes. So we are in Louisville, Kentucky, and May is Kentucky Derby month. So we made a Run for the Rosies mini thread pack. Now this is the limited edition thread pack. So if you want it, you need to snag it. And it has three really beautiful colors that will, I think they'll serve you well over time. They are colors that I use quite often, and they're beautiful shades of crimson and red and burgundy. So I think that you'll enjoy having those. And you can get those as the smaller cone, the 1,000 meter cone mini pack, or a 5,000 meter cone mini pack. And then the other thing, so we've been talking about grids. We've been talking about all kinds of grids, and we're gonna continue to talk about grids. And what I've done is we've put together a grid pack for you. So it has like the most useful stencils, the most useful grids I think that you're gonna enjoy. And that grid kit has three different stencils in it, and they are meant to go together. So these stencils, Kelsey, should I put it under the needle maybe?
Sure.
Okay, so the first stencil that you'll see in the pack is a straight 1-inch grid. Now, what's great about a 1-inch grid is you could always skip every other line and suddenly you have a 2-inch grid, right? So the magic of math, right? Or a 3-inch grid or a 4-inch grid. So that 1-inch grid can give you all kinds of sizes. That's why it's a magical, useful one to have in your studio. And then the grids that go along with it in the kit are meant to overlay on top. So as you see, this one is a, let me take the one out from underneath, is a diagonal grid. And it can go, you can mark it if you want. Some of the grid designs that we've done it's helpful to have a diagonal marked. And so this will just overlay and give you the diagonal automatically. You don't have to alter it in any way. And then the other grid that is in the kit goes along with that 1-inch grid as well. And it is a diagonal on a 1/2-inch grid. And again, you know, you don't have to do every line. You could mark every other one, every third one. So it'll give you a lot of different sizes out of just those three grids. And then, of course, an easy way to mark a grid would be with a pounce pad. So this is also, you can't see it? Oh, right, is this good?
Yeah.
Or should I hold it up? Okay. So this is a pounce pad. It has a terry cloth cover. You put the powder in it. I'm going to flip it over. So there's powder in here that goes inside the pad, and then you rub the pad over the stencils and it'll mark it on your fabric. That's in there. And then this is, so I always have new favorites, right? This is my new favorite pen. I have a lot of different favorite marking pens, but this is the new favorite I have. So it has air erasable on one side, it has wash out on the other side, and they really mark well. It goes on like butter. So that's also in the kit. And then we have a limited number of kits, not many because we've already sold quite a few, that include a book. This one is by a friend of mine, Dori Huskra, and it's called Making Connections, and she has all different grid designs. I mean, you know, lots of ones. We've barely scratched the surface of grid designs. Grid designs, there are thousands and thousands out there, and she's chosen some of her favorites in this book. So we have a grid kit, a stencil kit that you can order for grids that is with her book, and one that is without the book, so you can choose which one that you like. We don't have many of these books, so if you want one with a book, grab it before we're gone. Otherwise, we'll have the kits in the future, just probably not with the book. It's a quilting workbook, by the way. It's a great book. And anything else I need to say about that, Kelsey, before I?
I think so. I think I followed it.
Okay. All right, so let's talk grids. Let's talk about our ladybug that we've been talking about all year. And we've been talking about our ladybug, and we've been talking about our ladybug house and the levels of our house and the rooms in the house. And if at this point you're like, I don't know what you're talking about, lady, and ladybug, and what in the world are you talking about? You need to go back and watch the January 2021 Quilted Joy Clubhouse, because that's where we introduce you to our little ladybug friend, and we introduce you to the house and all of the rooms in her house and how she travels through the house. So it's just a fun way with the ladybug to talk about the path you're going to take to create grid designs. Now, we were working with like 9-patch or 16-patch grids when we talked about using our ladybug pathways. And in fact, I don't know, Kelsey, I'll hover the needle over. Let's look at this one. So this is one that we did last month, and in the Quilted Joy newsletter, you got a worksheet showing the thread path for this, but I know that looks complicated, and our ladybug looks like she was drinking that day because it's going all over the place, but it creates these kind of overlapping stars. It's super fun, and it's all based on her pathway through. But what I want you to understand is that grid designs, if instead of making a 3-story house in a border, you know, is probably going to be a 2 to 3 to 4 inch border, we could make a 2-story house in the border and do the same grid design. And it's going to be beautiful. It's just that with grids, you can stack them as many tall or as many wide rooms and levels of the house as you need for your ladybug. So in this case, we're going to talk about she's going to live in a ranch house, right? So a 1-story house. We're going to put a 1-story house for our ladybug in borders. But I want you to also play with, what if she had a 2-story house in a border? So it just depends on the size border and the commitment, right? So if you do a 1-inch grid in a 4-inch border, you're going to be there for a little while. So you need to kind of think about the density level of your ladybug's house and how big you want her rooms to be. In this case, today we're going to be talking about a ranch, and we're going to talk about how to make her turn the corner of your quilt. So I've got a border here pulled up on the computer, and I get asked this all the time. I am using a free program. It's called GIMP, G-I-M-P. It's similar to Photoshop, It's just free. And there's other programs out there that you may have on your computer. It's any kind of drawing program or photo program. You can probably draw with it. I'm just happy to use this one, and then I'm drawing with a graphics tablet to allow me, I don't have to use a mouse because a mouse is hard to do these kind of fluid designs. It's much easier to use a pen to draw with. All right, so we are going to look at, let's look at one of our ladybug designs that we've done before, which was just our lowercase e. So she was drawing. So our little ladybug was doing a lowercase e. That's her path, right? A lowercase e. So I'm going to start a little bit differently. Normally I would start up here in the attic, and this is her ranch, and I would go across and then come back. But I want to talk about how to turn a corner. So when you turn a corner, she's going to have kind of this weird shaped ranch house as far as how to get her to fill it. So I would go as deep as my throat, if you're using a long arm machine, as deep as you can go, as much real estate as you can cover. If you're using a sit down machine, then it's really up to you where you want to start and where you want to stop. So in this case, we'll start all the way down here at the bottom. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go, I think I'm going to go up this way. So I'm going to just do my lowercase e until I hit that. So basically I'm just going to go through, and I'm gonna do my lowercase e, and I'm leaving one side of my room undone because I'll catch that on when I come back. So she's just going up this wall, ceiling, and then I'm gonna go across the floor and up to this height. Now, if you're a little ladybug, if you need to break your threads because you didn't imagine the path, or you came across something and all of a sudden you know need to cut your threads and start over again, you haven't lost the game show. You've just cut your thread. It's not like you're a failure. You just cut your thread. I think so many times we put this pressure on ourselves to find that continuous path. And, some days you find it and some days you don't, but you just go with it. So she's going down. That's the wall. Wall of this room, ceiling, wall, wall, ceiling, wall, floor, 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 and it's just that lowercase e. We said our little ladybug was writing love letters. Lowercase e, lowercase e, lowercase e. I'm going to go across the floor, and I'm back to where I started. So that was a grid design that we did, goodness, Kelsey, I think it was January. Okay. And so we've just kind of made it work for a ranch house, for a border, and I've shown you how to turn the corner. So what you have to keep in mind is, like this, if it's a 2-inch border, you're going to break it into 2-inch chunks, right? You're going to need to mark your rooms, and they'll be 2-inch rooms. Sometimes, if you think about a border up against the main body of a quilt, the body of the quilt, the block of the quilt, the math in the quilt will give you the rooms for the ladybug. Because many times, if you have a 6-inch block that you're working with, it's broken into 2-inch units, 3 by 3, and that will give you the rooms, the registration lines, to mark your border to break it into chunks that directly match the units that the main body of the quilt is made from. So a lot of times the math between a border and the main quilt block will have something in common, and that's the size you can pull into the border design. All right, so let's take a look at another one. So we did that one. I'm gonna not go all the way up like we did before. I'm just gonna start with just this one. So another one that we did was we came in with a spike and back to the corner, and then we did a bunny hop. In with a spike and a bunny hop. In with a spike and a bunny hop. And I'm gonna go ahead and put one, I'm crossing into this room here, so I'm gonna go ahead and put a spike and a bunny hop and a spike and a bunny hop. And a spike and a bunny hop. And of course, where I'm putting a spike, you could put anything there. Like a curl would actually look pretty cool right there, or a little teardrop, or even like Oh, like a stacked curl might look cool there too. All right, now I'm gonna do a spike and go up this way. Spike, and a bunny hop, spike. And I would keep on trucking, but I'm gonna come back to where I started because I think you get the sense of how this works. I would just keep on keeping on. And now I'm gonna bunny hop here and spike and bunny hop and I'm done. And so that one, I've forgotten what we called it, but you can, spiked cathedral windows. Oh, good. So here, here is what we stitched out last month with that spiked cathedral windows. We did it, our ladybug had a three-story house with three rooms on each story, and this time we've given her a ranch instead. All right, so let's stitch out this on our fabric here, and I'm gonna use my Millennium to do so, and I'm gonna start, you see I have this 2-inch border stitched out, and I've used a marker so you can see it. I wouldn't do this on a real quilt, right? I used a Sharpie. I would use chalk pencil on a real quilt, but I wanted you to be able to see the registration lines easily. So let's do our little lowercase e and see how that looks. So, down that wall, ceiling, wall, ceiling. And then I'm gonna come back, because I think you get the idea of how our little ladybug can put her designs in a ranch house. Let me go ahead and break my threads. I just wanted you to see how easy it is to turn corners. I think it's one of the challenges with a free motion design is that when you see it a lot of times demonstrated and it's just in a straight border and you go, okay, well that's great, but how? What about the miter? How do I turn that corner? And that can be challenging depending on the whatever free motion design it is that you're using. But with grids, it's so much simpler because the grid does all that hard thinking for you. All right, so let's do our little spikes here in our little ranch house. And our ladybug, I'm gonna have her start up here in this top corner of our ranch house. So spike, bunny hop. I'm gonna go ahead and put that spike in there, but I probably didn't have to. Spike, bunny hop. And it's just really, it's a habit of mine when I come to something, I'm gonna do it on this side too. The first time I come to it, I'm gonna go ahead and deal with it because if my little brain skips it, then I always have a second chance to pick it up. So I'm gonna go ahead and do my spikes on each side just in case I were to forget it. I'm gonna come down, spike, and I'm gonna hop. Hop. I need one more spike there and hop up to the top. So there you go. They kind of, to me, they look like that, like a pillow that like Prince Charming would present the little slipper to Cinderella on. It's what they look like to me. So that would be that spiked cathedral inside a one-story border. All right, so I'm gonna push you one little step further, okay? So stay with me. If we take our little ladybug house, and instead of making it straight, we put our little ladybug house at an angle, we put it on point, we can kick up the beauty of our designs just by tilting her rooms. So take a look at this border that I have stitched out right below it. And I want you to see, can you see, Kelsey, can you see the marker that I did here?
Yeah.
Okay, great. And so I've gone through and I've used the stencil to give me these diagonal lines on the border. And again, I would use chalk. I would not use Sharpie. And now that I have her rooms tilted, she still operates with the house the way that she always has. It's just that this time we're all at an angle. So I'm gonna start here at that corner and take some tacking stitches. And so I'm gonna go through and I'm gonna go up this side of this room. And I'm just gonna do a little curl into the middle and then back out to the intersection. And that's gonna give me my little magic portal where I can drop into this next room of her house and a curl and then out to the corner. And I'm gonna go across the ceiling of this one and I'm gonna skip. There's a wall here, if you see that. I'm gonna skip that for now and I'm gonna keep on going across the top, curl and in, curl and in, curl and in, curl and in, and I think I'll stop there. I think you get the idea, and then I'm gonna come back and finish up her little rooms. So I'm gonna do that curl, and curl, and curl. All right, and I'm at this intersection, and I'm gonna deal with this mitered wall here of these where these two rooms come together. And so I'm gonna go ahead and go up this side, and then I'm gonna come down this side. All right, now look what happened. Do you see how the curls are going in opposite directions? That's because every time my ladybug hops, she hops and she curls in the same direction so that when I'm coming down the opposite way, the curls will spin. All right, let's do it across this floor. Curl into the intersection and curl into the intersection. And then I would keep on going, right? I would keep on, there's a curl there. And then there's a curl there and up. All right, so now we're gonna deal with these outside portions, the outside rooms of the house. And we're gonna do that same sort of thing where we come down the opposite side and curl. So she always curls in the same direction. It's just that the direction you take will spin those curls in an opposite way from each other. So I'm just gonna do all of the outsides here. And Kelsey, in our newsletter, we should do a blank border grid like this so that they can print it out and practice this as well as print it out to play with other ladybug paths. So let's do that in the sometime in May. Let's put that in the newsletter. All right, so we've got a miter here, and I'm just gonna go up that with a curl in the middle and then out to the edge, and then come back in and curl, and come back and curl in this intersection, and curl in this intersection, and curl in this intersection. There you go. All right, so let's take a look. Now, obviously, I would, if it were chalk, I would take those diagonal lines that I marked to give myself registration lines for my ladybug. I would take those off, but I just want you to see. Can you see okay, Kelsey?
Yeah.
Okay. And now that was, I believe I did that on a 3-inch space. That's one of those designs that you could do much bigger. But don't you love how the little curls are going opposite from each other and they just kind of spin? To me, it looks like wrought iron, like you'd find on a gate or something like that.
Fleur-de-lis,
yeah, funky fleur-de-lis. So I hope that was helpful. And I what I really want for you is I want you to play with some of those grid designs that we've done earlier in the year. And of course, we're going to continue on throughout 2021. I just want you to know you can all bring it back. It could be used for blocks for sure. It could be used for negative space for sure. But they're great border designs that turn the corner without much thought at all, which is perfect. Jesse, did we have any questions that we want to be sure we talk about?
I don't see any questions yet.
Okay. All right. So you guys, if you have any questions, we're going to keep on going, but definitely put them in the chat and we'll talk. All right. So I do want to take the time to thank our sponsor, APQS. APQS makes our long arm machines. They're 100% handcrafted in Iowa and they're loved the world over. They have a lifetime warranty on APQS machines, so you can quilt forever. And if you are interested in a APQS long arm machine, we certainly sell them here. You can certainly contact us here at Quilted Joy. I would love to chat with you about what you're looking for, but you can also contact your local dealer or your local APQS store, and you can find APQS machines over at apqs.com. So thanks so much, APQS. We really appreciate it. All right, I have the most amazing she shed to show you. You are going to love this. And this was, where was that? Was she Maine? Maine. And so it was a glorious, beautiful day. And when we chatted, she was outside. And I was like, okay, I know you're not storing your fabric outside. So why are we outside? Wait till you see why we're outside. You're going to love this. This is Deb Boucher, and we recorded this earlier. So take a look at this looky-loo.
Hi, Dad. Thanks so much for joining us.
Hi, Angela. How are you?
I'm good. Remind me, what city and state are you in?
I'm in a little town called Edgecombe, and we're in Maine.
There's in Maine.
About 1,300 people in town.
And it's a sunny day in Maine.
It's actually sunny and warm.
Oh, well, good. Well, good. Well, I'm so excited that you're going to give us a tour of your space. I can't wait to see it. Can you turn your camera around? Because you're outside, so I'm assuming you don't have your machine outside.
Right. There it is. That's my studio.
It's a little cute little cottage.
It is so great. It's just great.
Was that there when you moved into the house, or did you build that?
The left side was there. And then when we got my long arm, there really wasn't enough room for everything. So my husband said, okay, I'll put an addition on. So then he put on the right side.
Oh, what a nice hubby. Yeah.
So, and it's only a 30-second walk from the house, and the left side was built in the 50s. Our house was built in 1780.
Whoa.
The little old.
All right. Well, I can't wait to see it. Let's go inside.
Okay.
So a 30-second walk from the house to the she shed.
Yeah. I don't know how far it is from the backyard, but it's probably right, about
I would be skipping for the whole 30 seconds.
Yes. Except when it's icy.
Look at that. Oh, that is gorgeous. Oh, so I've already gotten distracted. That is a beautiful quilt.
This, my daughter did the painting, and I said, that needs to be a quilt.
Oh, and you made it into a quilt.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so fantastic. Oh, I bet she loves it.
Yes, she does. She's really happy how it came out.
Okay, so let's see what's in that so that we're in the left side of the she shed.
We're in the oldest part, yes.
Okay, show us what's in there.
Well, I've got I'm an Anglophile because my mother was born in England.
Uh-huh.
And so I grew up drinking tea, and these are teapots.
That's great. That's exactly where my cats would be, unfortunately. They'd all be up there peering down. That where you
this
cut?
This is where I work on my vintage machines.
Uh-huh.
Right here. I put one up just to show you what I do, and I have all my tools in there.
What a beautiful machine.
It is. It's a great machine. I have a red eye already, but this one has better decal, so I think I'll switch it out.
That's awesome.
There's a couple of my other older ones, and you can see I'm in the woods. You can see out the window.
Yeah.
So the countertop goes on two sides of.
Oh, perfect.
And my husband built it to specifications, what I needed for height, because I'm a pretty short person.
Uh-huh.
And he has built plenty of drawers. This has a little pullout. And that side has one as well. So I can just switch if I want to sit there, if I'm paper piecing, so you can cut and press.
Right.
So,
that's fantastic.
Let's see. There's
all your ribbons. Look at all your pretty ribbons.
There's not a lot, but.
Oh, those are great. You got the big purple and blue ones. If you're going to have a few ribbons, might as well have purple and blue ones.
That's from our local fair.
Oh, good. Oh, so look at the sheep.
Not last year. And I did this one. That's all in, the sheep are in wool, and the thistle is in wool. And
fantastic.
The sack.
And then I saw you have a cutting table in there too.
Yes, this is my cutting table.
Mm-hmm.
My husband found this on Craigslist. There's all storage on both sides. It's the perfect height. It's the perfect length and width. It's on rollers.
Uh-huh.
And I wanted a big ironing board. So he built an ironing board, and it can flip down if I wanted more room. Like if I teach a beginner class, I flip that down and it gives a little bit more room in here. Like I said, he did a fantastic job in here.
Yeah, that's great. I want to see the addition. What's in there?
This is the addition. You have to step up.
Uh-huh.
My long arm.
Great. And you have a what kind?
APQS Freedom.
A freedom that you have renamed.
Felicity.
That's fantastic.
Great. She just came back from a spa treatment in Iowa.
Great.
US. So she's and right.
What size table do you have?
12 foot.
A 12 foot table. Okay. All right. So
of how big the room is, you know?
Uh-huh. Yeah. How big is the room?
Let's see. At 12, maybe 14 by, I'm going to say maybe 12, 12 by 14, possibly.
Perfect.
So,
all right. Yeah, so I'm getting distracted by all your pretty thread. Okay. You have it laying on its side. Tell me why you chose to lay your thread on the side.
Because I wanted to see the color. Uh-huh. I wanted to be able to see it, to take a quilt over, choose my color, and no sun hits this, just the air. Again, my husband built it to my specifications. I have all my bottom line on the bottom and so fine on the top. And there's more teapots.
Well, that's so smart to have it. I hadn't thought about putting it on its side, but you can get more cones on that wall because you've got them on their side versus standing up straight, can't you?
Yes, correct. And it really is helpful. I did have to go and get a little shelf at Lowe's, I think, last summer because I was running out of room. So.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. So what else do you have behind your machine there?
Okay. I have more of my old machines. There's another little one.
So and, cute.
My books.
Yeah.
Instructions and this is another old machine that I have. This is a parlor cabinet. There's a Singer in there with Phoenix decals and it pops up. And it pops down. So it's really interesting. I didn't open that one up, but this is another one with a coffin top. That's a new home. And this one is a Wilcox and Gibbs.
Wow.
With the glass feet. It has glass feet.
Oh my word.
Yeah. And they're very rare. And somebody was downsizing. Again, my husband is an enabler. So he found and we went and got her. So
glass feet. Goodness.
Yeah, glass feet.
I guess if you didn't have plastic, you got to have something.
Exactly. And there's
more teapots, right?
More
teapots. Yeah, my cats would be all in those shelves. Yeah.
The cats do not come out here. dogs. This is my 201.
Goodness.
Which I absolutely adore. You're that so machine. Pretty. And, a spinning wheel. We've had that since when we got married. He made me a quilt rack.
Beautiful.
And more teapots.
More teapots. Fantastic.
This is my
stash. Oh, good. We get to see in the closet. Oh, good. Yep. So you have all of your fabric in plastic bins sorted by color?
Color. By
color. Wonderful.
So I made him fix the doors Sunday. I said, you need to fix the doors because I know they're going to
because Angela's going to be nosy and she's going to want to look in the closets.
And there's some more old machines in there as well. So
fantastic.
So that's that. What else do I have?
Oh,
I
and have are we back at
a kitchen area here. Which does not have kitchen stuff in it. There's one shelf that has, an electric kettle and tea bags and things like that. But most of it holds ribbon and my rulers, my tools that I need to maintain the machine.
And a comfy chair.
More teapots.
And more teapots. Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say, you're going to have a place in that kitchen area to make tea, Deb, because you can't have that many teapots and not make tea.
I do have, another counter. Oh, it's and my little refrigerator. That's the coolest thing. This little refrigerator. Have you seen those on Amazon?
I don't even know what I'm looking at. Is it that white cube thing?
Yeah. Did I?
That's a refrigerator.
Yeah. It's a little tiny fridge, little mini fridge. Only has one bottle of water in it, but it's a little mini.
Oh, cute! cute. Well, if you would turn the camera around so we can see you, Deb, because I got some questions. That's good. I love seeing your space, Deb. Tell me three things that you would recommend to your bestie right now. They don't have to be quilt related, but something that you think is kind of cool or fun right now.
Well, I would recommend Barbara Brackman's encyclopedia. I just got mine last week and I've been just going through it and looking and going through it. And I got the block base for EQ8 so that I'm looking at that too.
So for those who don't know, so it's got thousands, right, of block patterns?
Yeah.
Yep. And it's just an encyclopedia of like every block pattern known to man, basically, exactly, in there that you can use for designing your own quilts.
Yep, exactly.
Wonderful. Yeah, I've been looking at that book too.
I think the other one is my dogs. I absolutely adore my dogs. You know, I just cannot live without a dog, but I got one and then I said, well, she needs a companion. So I got one.
And what kind of dogs are they?
They are Cavalier King Charles Spaniels. If you can see.
Do you have one there nearby?
I do. Should I switch the?
Yeah. Yeah. I want to know what a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel is. There. So cute.
It is the Blenheim and she's almost three and Tessa is black and white and she's about 9 months.
And so, it's nap time.
Yeah, it's nap time. They've been outside all day, so not typical.
All right, Deb, can you turn the camera around so we can see you again?
There I am.
Well, Deb, if people want to connect with you online, where can they find you?
They can find me on Facebook. I have a business page and it's T Rose Quilting. And fabulous. I have an email, troseQuilting@gmail.com as well.
And now we know why it's T Rose Quilting.
Yes, exactly.
We understand that. Great. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for your time, Deb. I love your space. Like I said, would be skipping for that 30 second walk from the house to the she shed. You have a lovely little shed there to play in.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandra. So much fun and nice to meet you, Angela.
All right. I'll see you later. See you in the clubhouse. Thanks so much. Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Don't you just love her space? Deb, I swear, if I were there, you'd have to build an addition so you could put a bed in there because I would just sleep in your she shed. Isn't that awesome? Thank you so much for allowing us to take a peek and be nosy and see your beautiful space. And I encourage you to go over to the Quilted Joy Clubhouse and let Deb know how much you loved it and how much you loved her teapots. Weren't those amazing? It's always fun to see how other people have their creative spaces laid out. I wish that mine were as elaborate as that. Mine is definitely not as elaborate as that, but it's so much fun to see what others are playing in, what their sandbox looks like. So thanks, Deb. So we have a number of new things that have come into the shop, but I wanted you to see one that's made by one of my quilting heroes, Beth Ann Nemish. And she's come out with so many great rulers that you can use on both a sit-down machine and a stand-up machine. So they'll work either way. But she has a new line of rulers out that we have here in the shop, and they are called the Love Line Rulers. And I don't know if you've seen these. They're pretty new. But you can make, with these rulers, you can make nested hearts. You can actually use the spines of these two for spines for feathers, and you can use them for the actual plume of the feather as well. And one of the unique things about how Beth Ann does this is she has these little pinholes in all of her rulers that help to align so that, you know, it's hard with this big wide curve to align them together, and that pinhole helps. And she's got a lot of great YouTube videos showing you how to use her rulers, and like I said, they're both for sit down and stand up. So these are the Love Line rulers, and I think that you would enjoy them. And then we did get a question that came in. Jesse said that somebody asked if all of the grid designs that we've been working on, if they're just for long arm machines. No, it's just that it's a different tool to use, but it's the same path. So you can absolutely do this on a sit-down domestic. In fact, I encourage it because with grids, you just have a very short space to go before you repeat your motif, before you repeat like the lowercase e. And so it can be pretty simple to do on a sit-down machine because it's not these long flowy things. It's you've just got kind of little pre-marked grid and little short synapses that you're putting down onto your fabric. So yes, anything that we show you in the clubhouse, it can be both sit down and stand up. It's just sit down machine quilters are using a different tool to achieve the same thing, but the path would be exactly the same. So, all right. And then in the Quilted Joy Clubhouse, I wanted to tell you, so each month we go through and we ask folks to submit a photograph of an unquilted quilt top, and then I select one and bring it in here to show you how I would quilt it if it were my quilt. So this month I selected Linda's quilt, and I love this quilt. I'm not sure what the name of the pattern is called, but one of the things I found super intriguing about her quilt is that they're rectangles instead of squares. And so sometimes that can be a challenge when it comes to how to quilt it. So I really, and I also like this kind of the applique where it's just in the top left and top bottom right corner to frame out that quilt. And the colors and all, it's just absolutely gorgeous. I could see my cats sitting right on top of it, Linda. So I appreciate you submitting it. So let's take a look at how I would quilt this if it were my quilt. And I'm just gonna zoom in here so that we can see a little bit more easily. And I wanna zoom in. It's hard sometimes at an angle for me to draw. So I'm just gonna pick one of these ones that is and blow it up. So it's a rectangle, right? So you've got a strip here. I'm guessing that's a 2-inch strip. I'm guessing this is a 2-inch strip. And I'm guessing that this center piece is probably a 4x2-inch strip is my guess. I have no idea, but that's my guess. And so what I thought about doing was taking that spiked cathedral window grid, because I want you to see how grids, it doesn't have to be a perfect square. Your ladybug can have elongated rooms. She can have a ballroom in the middle of her house, and it's still gonna work the same way. So I'm gonna do that spiked cathedral, and I'm gonna start up here in the attic. And what I wanna do first is I wanna just imagine, and I'm gonna draw this here. So there's a registration line there. There's a registration line here. I'm dividing up my house, her rooms, right? There's one here, there's one here. And what I wanna do is I'm gonna ignore this room. I'm gonna make this her ballroom, right? So there's one, there's a room, ballroom. She's got 1, 2, 3, 4 ballrooms. She's a fancy ladybug in her house. All right, so I would chalk that out so that I know where the rooms of her house are. She's gonna be up here in the attic. She's gonna drop down to the first room at the top level of her house, a spike, a hop, a spike. I'm gonna change my pixel size here of my pin because it was just so big, yeah. And then a hop. And a spike, spike, hop, spike, hop the ballroom, spike, hop, spike, spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop, spike. And literally that's going on in my head. If I don't have something going on in my head, I'm gonna get lost here. Spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, spike, hop. At some point, there's a magic portal. Every time I touch this corner, let me change colors so that you can see what I'm talking about. I need to deal with this interior of this block. And do you see where I'm touching the corner? I touched it here and here. I'm here and I'm gonna touch it over here. At some point, I'm gonna use that magic portal to drop into the center of this block. All right, so spike, hop, let's do it now. So I'm gonna do the same thing. Spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop. So now my inside's taken care of. Now I'm gonna go back to this ballroom and this wall, hop. And let's go up this way. Hop, hop, spike, hop, spike, hop. And I'm gonna come back down. I need a spike. Hop, spike, hop, 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 spike, hop, spike. And now we go back up to the ceiling. So it's an elongated grid, basically, but it will frame out everything, and as it comes together it looks really, really great. So let me turn off that one and turn on this one, and let me zoom out. And this was a lot, Linda, to draw, so I just did a portion of your quilt rather than the whole thing. because I got very tired last night. So that's as far as I got. But you get the idea of how it goes together. And as it meets up with its neighboring blocks, the grid matches. And so it will just flow through your whole quilt top with that grid. I think it's going to look awesome. Okay, so Linda, the next thing I was looking at were your applique on the outside to corners. And so one of the things that I always love to do with applique is to go ahead and outline those. I would go ahead and go around your applique shapes and outline those applique shapes to nail those down, including the little floating flowers that you have. I don't know what size these are. You may want to go in and add like veins to your leaves so that it doesn't get kind of poofy on you. But you can see that I went through and went around all of the shapes. That's how I would kind of stitch that and nail that down. Okay, so then I got to thinking about these other two corners, the bottom left and the top right. And I always love when the quilting nods to the piecing or the quilting nods to the applique. And so what I would do is maybe in a sparkly thread, like a sparkly gray thread, I would repeat and restitch this whole motif in the corners. So I would make some wax paper templates or like cardboard templates and mark this same applique design, but stitch around it with thread, not applique. And so if you take a look here, so I just repeated it. So now it's in all four corners. Two of the corners are applique and the other two are kind of the shadow kind of whisper of what's going on in the other two corners. I think that'll look really great. And then there's these kind of empty spaces in these four corners of the quilt. And so this side piece here, this kind of central unit that your applique is growing off of, I would restitch just that central unit inside each of those four kind of areas of four points of the quilt. And so you can see that right there. So I just reuse the same shape in those four points. And then I would probably switch to something that matches, like a black, and just do a meander to kind of fill in these spaces. I wouldn't really draw attention to them. I don't think that background is just floating. It's not something I want to, you know, put feathers in or piano keys or anything like that. I just want it to kind of melt away. And there you go, Linda. That's how I would quilt your quilt. Of course, Linda, you can quilt your quilt however you like, but I would love to see what you decide to do. So I encourage you to post it over there in our Facebook group and the Quilted Joy Clubhouse, because everybody would love to know how you decided to quilt your quilt. All right, and speaking of which, we had a lot of great photos put up there in the Quilted Joy Clubhouse. You guys are just the nicest, kindest quilters, the most helpful and talented group. I just really love seeing what you're working on. So let's take a look at just some of the things that were posted. I couldn't put them all on here. And I have to tell you, Megan, when I saw this, I about fell out of my chair. So you guys, she posted these three quilt tops that she did as Quilts of Valor. And these are my designs. These are my piecing patterns. These are ones that I've done for the Fonz and Porter Love of Quilting TV show. And they've run in the Love of Quilting magazine as well. And so the one on the far left, that is Moonhopper. And then, the other name just flew right out of my head. I've got it on Facebook. Ribbons of Valor. Thank you. Ribbons of Valor. And so in the Facebook group, in our Quilted Joy Clubhouse Facebook group, I did put links to those patterns. But I tell you, you know, when you create a piecing pattern, like, you know, you like it because it's yours, right? But when somebody else decides that they like it too and they make it, I mean, it's just like lightning strikes. It's just like the coolest feeling ever. And I just really love, she put a plaid in there with the moon hopper in the sashing design. And Megan, you just, thank you for posting that. You absolutely made my day. So lovely. And then Kathy posted this. This is one of those dream big panels. And she used it to put feathers and free motion quilting. And she said that she used some of her grid designs and some of the petals, and that with feathers, one of the things that really helped her was when she watched our November 2020 and December 2020 Clubhouse meeting, where we talked about the traditional Amish feather wreath. And she said that the way that we showed how to make a traditional feather wreath just completely changed her way of thinking, and that it made feathers far more easy. It just clicked with her. And it's always nice to hear that, you know, that something that you've kind of thought maybe might be helpful is actually helpful to somebody. So I appreciate you letting me know, Kathy, and you did a beautiful job. And then Kim posted this one. This is a panel quilt, but isn't this fun? I really love how she dressed up the outside borders of her panel quilt, made it bigger, and still made it fun. I think she made that for her son. Good job, Kim. And then Barbara posted this one. She used ruler work on the inside of the star points, and then she did this beautiful scalloped edge with feathers on that outside border as well. Nice job, Barbara. Naomi said that she has made over 1,000, was this the one? I think this was the one. Yeah, Naomi said that she had made 1,000 masks for COVID, and she took all of the scraps from all of those masks and made a scrap quilt to remind her of this time in her life where during the pandemic, she made so many masks. So I love that, Naomi. Great, great job. So thank you so much for posting. I would love to see what you're working on too. And if you have any, you know, questions, or you have any like suggestions of stuff that we can cover in Clubhouse, just let me know. Just put it there in the Clubhouse. You can also always go over to quiltedjoy.com and send us a message through the website as well. Jesse, did we have any other questions come through?
I don't think so. Brenda was asking about options other than a chalk pounce. What else would you use to mark your grid?
So to mark the grid, a pounce is nice. And if you're worried about pounce because it's bouncing on you, generally that's a sign that you've put too much down. And sometimes if you spritz a little water on the surface of the fabric first, not like wet it, just little bit of spritz, it will help the chalk sit where it's supposed to and not bounce around on you. Just make sure you're not using washout chalk, right? Because then you'll just wash it right away. So pay attention to the kind of chalk that you're using. Otherwise, you can use just a chalk pencil. You could use one of those markers that we showed before where it's an air erase or it's a water erase marker. Of course, if you use an air erase marker to mark your grid, you're committed for that day to get it done, right? Because it's going to leave. You don't want to mark it the whole thing and then, you know, be surprised when you get to the bottom and it's gone. So in my opinion, you need all the markers, just all of them. You just need to try all of them because each of them have different uses, and you're going to find one that you like. But I like the really skinny chalk markers. We have some by Soline that you'll find on the website. I don't have one sitting over here, but it's a really fine tipped ceramic chalk marker that'll get you some nice grid markings. You can use it with stencils too, where you just go in that groove of the stencil and just draw it in the groove to transfer that grid design onto your fabric. Any other questions?
There's a question about if we wash quilts before we get them back. I know we don't wash any of the quilts that are brought in here.
So before I give a quilt to anybody, I wash it. Now, we quilt for others here. So when somebody asks us to quilt their quilt, we don't wash it for them, right? But I'm talking about in a gift giving situation. So I make a quilt for you. Before I give it to you, I'm going to wash it. For one thing, the batting utterly changes personality. It becomes snuggly and cozy. And that's the first impact that I want to make with that gift. I want it to be snuggly and cozy. And second, if there's a fabric that's going to run, I want to deal with it. I don't want them to wash it the first time and feel like they've ruined their quilt. All right. I want to know about it and I want to deal with it, not them. So yes, I absolutely wash every single quilt before I give it to the recipient because it completely changes the whole voice of the quilt. So
when you've marked a quilt?
When I've marked a quilt.
What's your process for cleaning it out before you send it back to the customer?
So to clean the marks, you know, it depends on what you're using. So if it's a wash away, generally just a spritz of water, and let it dry, that'll come out. But I really love, Kelsey, I'm going to put this is it's made by Soline, and it's just water. It's like a water marker. And so it gets the water, rather than spritzing it everywhere, I can just go on the lines of the grid, and it's just, you know, like a felt tip marker with water that I put in it. So I really love that for taking it out. For taking off chalk, you know those really cheap red velour lint brushes from the dollar store? Those are great for taking off chalk, pounce chalk. For taking off the like ceramic chalk, they come with erasers that work really well, but they'll also many times just a little, this little water pen, the Soline pen. And like I said, we have these in the shop if you're looking for them, but I use that all the time. So just, you don't want to mix the streams, right? You don't want to put iron off pounce next to a wash away pen, because if you hit the iron off pounce with an iron, you're going to set the wash away pen. So don't mix the streams. Okay, so next month's program is on Wednesday, June the 2nd. It is at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 o'clock Pacific, 10 a.m. Pacific. And we are gonna be talking now about diagonals. We've already turned our little ladybug house on in a tilted way to get us through a border. Now we're gonna look at how, if her whole house, if all of the rooms, all of the levels of her house were tilted, what would we gain by that? So we're gonna work on diagonal grids on June 2nd, and I hope you'll join me there. Otherwise, I'll see you in the clubhouse. Thanks so much.